Welcome to Quixaya, Guatemala. This little town is one of the most impressive examples of ecological and community management that I've seen in almost 14 years of world travel. In this episode, I intend to highlight the ancestral knowledge that informed the transformation of this valley from one that used to be under monocrop cultivation and exploited its workers to the abundant and rich landscape that now nourishes the community that is supported by it. Join us as we explore the effective use of passive irrigation, the community structure that incentivizes cooperation, and we'll take an in-depth look at the way that the local people here have leveraged the resources of three main microclimates to build perennial resilience in this ecosystem.
Bueno, mi nombre es José Armando, soy originario de la comunidad Quixaya. Quixaya significa en el idioma cachiquel maya, Quixia, que se pronuncia Quix, corazón, ya, que es agua. Entonces estamos justamente en el corazón del agua, que la cual durante mucho tiempo ha estado yo viviendo en este pueblo.
First, we're going to take a look at the aquatic systems, and this is where they get their main cash crop, which is watercress. Now, watercress is an amazing addition to this ecosystem because it was naturally seeded in the water systems even when they got here. The watercress here is a very low maintenance system and is basically a byproduct of the effective dispersal of water in their terraced aquatic systems. All of the byproducts of the production of watercress are beneficial as well. It even filters the water as it runs through the terraced aquatic systems, and the algae that grows around the watercress is used as an animal feed.
En la comunidad siempre en la producción de berro, porque son 2 kilómetros lineal de producción que ha estado apoyando a la economía de comunitaria, que eso ha sido el principal actor, ¿verdad?, de la producción. Y no tenemos como un proveedor o algo, un mercado, más que nosotros mismos, las mismas familias quienes siembran, lo cortan y lo distribuyen a los mercados. Entonces, nosotros plantamos la producción y la llevamos al mercado para generar nuestra propia economía comunitaria.
The second major microclimate here are the humid zones. And these are being effectively leveraged for cultivation of staple crops like corn, papayas, bananas, and much more.
Cuando yo llegué aquí, casi la mayoría ya no consume lo que antes se consumía, lo que son las hierbas. Los niños ya no consumen eso, pero ahora sí se pueden dar cuenta ustedes de que se está recuperando lo que se había quedado antes, lo que se estaba perdiendo, ahora se está recuperando. Lo que son las hierbas, los vegetales, las frutas, se sabe de que son lo mejor para nuestro cuerpo y es eso de que se tiene que consumir más.
The last of the three major microclimates are what they call the dry zones. Now, these aren't dry zones in the way that you would normally think of them. They still get a lot of rain during parts of the year, but they're not under active irrigation from the river system the way the other areas are. Almost all of these dry zones are underneath forest cultivation, with an understory cash crop of coffee, slower maturing fruit trees like avocados, and the production of lumber for construction and for firewood. So this is where they cultivate their food forests. And there are so many excellent gilded systems around here that I could show you. This tree right here locally is called cuisine, better known in English as an ice cream bean. This is what the pods look like, although this one is already rotted out. It's got very sweet, fleshy fruit on the inside and ants that are about to bite my hand. This nitrogen fixer is really well known for sequestering nitrogen out of the air, putting it into the soil for the benefit of the plants around it.
super, papá.
Sí, sí. Right next to it, we've got coffee, which is an excellent perennial understory crop for a forestry system. Especially in this climate, it does really well. And we get to see it, fortunately, while it's in flower. You can see how lush these leaves are and how many different cherries are going to come off of this plant once it starts to fruit. We have a mango tree, and it's a little early in the season, but you can see some of the fruit starting to develop already. And in a very small distance in this area around, these gilded fruit tree and functional tree systems all support each other and help to hold nutrients and moisture in the soil even this late in the dry season. Another one of the benefits of the Kushin tree is that it leaves a lot of excellent leaf litter. This not only helps to give nutrients in the soil below and helps support the species that are growing around it, but it also shades the soil underneath to keep it from overheating and to keep it from drying out. If you excavate down just a little bit, even this late in the dry season, you can find fairly moist topsoil. This is extremely rich and enriched with the leaf litter that this tree is giving as a support species. The story of how this community formed is quite unique. All this area was originally owned by a single finquero, or plantation owner. When the plantation owner fell on hard times, he ended up racking up a lot of debt and defaulted to the bank, who repossessed this entire piece of land and offered the community around it the option of either taking a cash buyout or re-inheriting the land that they used to own. And the original 80 families of this community were given equal-sized plots all throughout this land to cultivate and to nurture in any way that they saw fit.
Bueno, anteriormente yo tenía que depender de un trabajo, trabajar para los finqueros. Entonces, más bien te explotan y tienes que trabajar duro y por un salario mínimo. En cambio, hoy que estoy trabajando para mí, estoy trabajando, bueno, para ayudar a la comunidad, porque lo que nosotros sembramos lo vendemos acá mismo. Y estoy también a diario conectado con la naturaleza, con el ambiente que acá tenemos, es maravilloso. Y sí, hay más satisfacción para mí, porque estoy conviviendo en la naturaleza y con los amigos, y cada día aprendemos más.
Bylaws for this community were drawn up to prohibit the sale of the land of any of this area to anyone outside of the community. For this reason, ownership of the land has stayed in the hands of all of the descendants of the original families who reclaimed it. To this day, there are no taxes collected and no dues paid to the structure or the government that looks over this area. Instead, everyone contributes in the improvement of the infrastructure and community projects whenever those arise. Much like many communities around the world, one of the biggest problems here is the processing and removal of trash. Most parts of Guatemala lack the infrastructure and the funding for proper trash disposal, and in many places it just piles up on the outskirts of town where people are unable to deal with it or process it in a way that removes it as a contaminant from the ecosystem.
Ya que también no tuvimos la oportunidad de una formación escolar, entonces donde también la mucha falta de conocimiento en el manejo del reciclaje, que la gente en nuestros pueblos no tienen esa conciencia de cómo ir cuidando también esa potencia, entonces tenemos problemas con el de la basura, que es bastante grande en la comunidad. Si nosotros no conservamos nuestras semillas nativas, no cuidamos este gran ecosistema, en unos 3, 4, 5 años se van a ir desapareciendo, ¿verdad? También si nosotros no creamos un modelo de ecosistema, de protección a toda esa gran potencia de la riqueza que hay en Quixayá, podría ser que aquí a 5 años la gente no va a tener conciencia con la naturaleza y botarán todos los árboles. Entonces son como grandes retos que nosotros estamos haciendo de crear conciencia para diversificar, apostar a la diversificación, de lo que ya tenemos, cómo diversificar más y conservar toda esa gran riqueza de la flora y la fauna en Quixayá.
As is common in many other parts of Guatemala, the lack of economic resources around here has incentivized certain members of the community to take the easy way of cultivating their crops by using chemical fertilizers and herbicides for faster turnover and a quicker way to market. Because of the way that this valley is configured, all things upstream very quickly affect those down below. And the use of any chemical fertilizers or herbicides can quickly contaminate parcels that other people in the community own further downstream. And though this valley may be blessed with many different ecological resources, money is still hard to come by. As a result, increasingly members of this community are leaving this area to find better job opportunities in Guatemala City or other parts of this area. The community members that remain are working as hard as they can to incentivize other community members to stay here, take care of their land, and continue to contribute to the community, even if the economic resources and incentives might not yet be here.
Tenemos riqueza con los terrenos, o a lo mejor también contamos con esa riqueza natural, pero realmente no tenemos como la habilidad, el conocimiento y esa conexión con la naturaleza. Y es por eso que nos alejamos del lugar y buscar otra manera de vida. Que yo anteriormente no tenía esa conciencia con la naturaleza. Yo vivía con una mente diferente de poder estudiar e irme a la ciudad y ganar un poco de dinero y estar también con esa esclavitud. Pero me di cuenta de que no era un modelo como bueno para mí. Vine y regresé porque también quería adquirir esos conocimientos grandes de los abuelos, cómo ellos manejan la agricultura, cómo cultivan la diversificación. Dije que tenía que como crear una zona para poder disfrutar bajo sombra. Planté los árboles frutales, que fue semillas nativas que yo conseguí con los abuelos, y planté mis propios aguacates, mi propio papaya, mi propio mango. Entonces la cual yo tuve que tomar esa iniciativa de plantar algo. Pero si yo no hubiera tomado esa iniciativa, entonces yo nunca estuviera ahorita poder disfrutar de esa producción. Entonces no se requiere de dinero, sino se requiere de voluntad, de tener esa misma iniciativa, de poder hacerlo. Ahora yo invito a esa gente, a estas personas que ven esos videos, para que puedan venir a conocer y ver esa iniciativa de lo que nosotros como jóvenes agricultores ya tenemos plasmado en la comunidad, que actualmente podría decirles de que un 60% de mi comida, de todo de lo que consumen en mi casa, ya viene de mi propia granja. Entonces, teniendo esa iniciativa de poder hacerlo, yo creo que es el primer paso que podemos dar para poder crear un modelo como esta.
Despite all of these challenges, which certainly aren't unique to this community alone, the inhabitants of Quixayá have been able to do an amazing amount with very few monetary resources, and in many cases, little or no access to formal education. This is the perfect example, and the reason why I wanted to do the first episode here, to show people that even without many of the resources that we consider necessary for very fast development, cooperation and the power of community can be leveraged for this type of ecological abundance.